like I have a lot of friends that I went to high school and college with that revel in knowing where they will be next week, next Wednesday, a year from Wednesday, and so on and so forth. And that safety and that comfort of that's, I know my neighbors, these are my neighbors, they're not leaving. That consistency, there are people that thrive in that. Yeah. And I don't besmirch that at all, and I don't look down on that. I just could not be more polar opposite.
Billboard once called Ryan Tedder the undercover king of pop.
Would you rescue me when I'm by myself? When I need your love, if I need your help, would you rescue me?
And it's probably a pretty accurate title. I filmed and recorded this episode with him just before the COVID-19 outbreak, and I can tell you firsthand, he's a genius. You might know him as the frontman for One Republic. What you may not know is that Ryan is a music industry veteran, in-demand producer, and songwriter behind the songs for Adele, Beyonce, Kelly Clarkson, Paul McCartney, and Taylor Swift, to name a few. He has a show on TV called Songland. He's an active investor in several categories, including commercial real estate. His latest venture has him jumping into the incredibly competitive beverage space with a drink called Mad Tasty. That's an all-natural, hydrating, restorative water beverage with zero sugar, no calories, and 20 milligrams of hemp extract with a flavor that's shockingly good. I've tasted it. His latest song, Didn't I, with One Republic, sounds like an instant hit. Hope you enjoy this episode as much as I did. Didn't we fly?
I'm Ryan Tedder. I'm a songwriter, producer, TV personality, and the lead singer of One Republic. And right now, you're watching Behind the Brand with Brian Elliott.
Hit a coffee shop on 8th. Well, maybe it was in my mind. And I swear that I heard your laugh from a person that walked past me at a party the other night. Never thought we'd ever have to go without. Take you over anybody else, hands down. We're the top of.
So do you think that's what gets people stuck? This fear of failure or analysis paralysis, they don't take action.
Paralysis by analysis, oh my God. I have friends, I'm related to some people. Paralysis by analysis is a life stealer, a dream killer. Overthinking, fear. Two people, as far as I've understood in my lifetime.
Yeah. Well, you know, let's be clear. So caution in some professions is really good.
Of course.
We're really glad that the airplane pilot, you know, she doesn't say like, you know, I'm going to take a chance today. I'm going to go for this.
Let's go up to 60,000 feet.
Let's just go for it.
Cabin pressure.
Or your surgeon, right?
Yeah.
And so, you know, in some occupations, that works really well.
Yeah. Now, there are also surgeons that do big boulder, big rock climbing and take their lives into their own hands in ways that I would never imagine and are far bigger risk takers than I am. I think a surgeon, first of all, my sister-in-law is a surgeon, the idea of cutting on another human being is so much riskier than anything I would ever attempt in life from my perspective.
Yeah.
But I understand the point you're making. I think that people, as best as I can tell, are governed by two fundamental drivers, fear and legacy. And those two things, and when I say legacy, pursuing money is the fear of being broke to some extent, right? And we all have that residing in us. I was broke. I didn't come from money. I had periods in my childhood where we were well below poverty and getting evicted, and then went into the middle class world for a while, and then after I graduated was back to broke and getting evicted. That's always in the back of my mind, but it's not a... It's not something at this point, I definitely don't do things for money. I do things to preserve and protect the money I've made. I do a lot of commercial real estate, buy big old boring office buildings and Walgreens and stuff like that. That's more just like long-term, you know, I'm trying to be smart. Legacy and fear, I think, govern people a tremendous amount. Legacy, what can I do, whether that is even wealth building? What am I doing with commercial real estate other than building a legacy for my descendants? Am I worried that they're going to be broke? No, not necessarily. So why are you doing it? Well, and then if you have to really get deep on that in meta, you go, why am I doing that? I don't know. That's what people do, I guess. Fear.
Seems like you're diversifying your portfolio.
I'm diversifying my portfolio. Exactly. My business manager would be happy.
You don't have all your eggs in that one basket.
No, I'm definitely, you know, I was about to put it all in Bitcoin, and then I thought, pause, hold that thought. Wait a minute. Let's see what happens.
Yeah. Can I just point out what I see in you, though, is a common thread? Collaboration.
Yes. 100%.
I mean, if it's commercial real estate, it seems like, I don't think that you're doing that alone.
Oh, no. You get hammered.
Singer-songwriter.
Yeah.
You're the front man.
Yeah.
But I would assume that that's pretty collaborative as well.
It's very collaborative.
Writing songs. Let's just maybe do a short list for people
for
who
sure.
don't know your resume of some of these songs that you've written for other people.
Yeah.
Adele.
Adele, yeah.
Beyonce.
Yeah.
Taylor Swift.
Yeah.
Who else?
McCartney.
Yeah.
Jonas Brothers, Sucker, more recently.
Yeah.
Thomas Rhett.
Yeah.
Nothing a Beer Can't Fix, more recently. One Republic, yeah. I've been fortunate enough to work with pretty much every artist that I like, and it is about collaboration. You hit the nail on the head. Somebody asked me in an interview recently, how do you maintain all these pots, these spinning plates? First of all, I actually thrive in that. I waited tables for years. I love it. I would still wait tables. I love waiting tables if anybody's hiring. I was the guy that, like, you have a 3-table limit per section,
mm-hmm.
or 4 if they thought you could handle it. I would see, can I do 6? I would take, if somebody's in the weeds,
push,
I'd be like,
limits.
Give me your table. I got it.
Yeah.
I wanted to see, what is my bandwidth capacity?
Yeah.
It is all about collaboration, though. I will not do that. There's one common thread in every single thing that I do. I will not jump into anything that I don't have full mastery of already by myself, which means there's really nothing else that I'm going to jump into at this stage of my life if I do not have a strategic partner that, and this is the key thing, knows more about what we're doing than I do.
Yeah.
Whether it's buying a building, my partners are way smarter than me and way more, 50 years more experience in commercial real estate. Producing a film, Margot Robbie speaks for herself. Her husband, Tom, speaks for himself. Brian Unkles is the fourth of the four amigos. He did I, Tonya, Bright. He did the new Harley Quinn movie, and he did Hunger Games. He knows what he's doing.
Yeah, you don't need to be the driver. You can ride shotgun.
Let me be. Let an arm be an arm, let a leg be a leg, in all cases. And for me, that allows me also to lean into what I'm good at. And a friend of mine recently, when he refers to songwriters and people, he always says, well, their superpower is lyrics. Their superpower is melody. And I think that's an interesting term, but like, let everybody flex on their superpower and you just flex on yours. So I know what I'm gonna bring to the table. And then if we each are firing on all cylinders and we're not overextended, then in theory, that's gonna lead us to the best outcome of whatever the project is.
So did you see him take off again, right? Kids are following him down the street. Cut to the good kids riding it the other way. And they're coming to rescue this kid, right? And the kid's still running. And these kids are like yelling at him on their bikes, they're shaking their bats, whatever. Finally, he rounds a corner, sees all his friends. Cut to the bad guys on the bike. They screech to the halt here. All 5 of the good kids doing this.
Yeah,
and
I wouldn't have done this if I didn't have the partners that I have. If it's songwriting, if it's an album, all of it.
Well, it's this mentality that great ideas can come from anywhere.
Yes.
I think I was reading a story when, you know, I can't remember if you were writing it for Ed Sheeran or someone else. And then Ed wrote, I think you were in London with Ed, and Ed ended up writing the song that ended up being the song.
Yes, that's correct.
And, you know, he thought your song was there, and then he wrote a little bit better one. You're like, dude.
That's it.
That's better.
Yeah, I wrote a song with Ed called Happier on Divide, on his last album. And then it was the first single for a while. It's this big mid-tempo emotional, like, huge, huge song. But it's the kind of song where if it doesn't come first, it may not come, or it's going to come last, right? And a lot of times that's the way albums work. And then I happened to be crashing at his place in London, staying the night, and we were promoting One Republic stuff. I was there for a day. He comes through, we stayed up till 3 in the morning drinking whiskey, and he plays me a song that he wrote that day called Shape of You. And I was like,
little song.
It's like, so he's like, what do you think? I was like, I think that our song, Happier, will not be the first single. That's what I think. And he was writing for another artist when he wrote it.
So many great lessons I want to underscore. I want to go back to your entrepreneurial spirit. the lesson I think that I see is something that my mentor, Seth Godin, taught me. And he said, you know, sometimes the riskiest thing you can do is play it safe.
100%.
But on the outside looking in, a lot of these people who are risk averse, you know, the people who like to know what's going to happen next, they want a script, they want bullet points, whatever. Yeah. Those people think that we're risk takers.
Yeah.
And that's really not the case.
No.
We are risk mitigators.
100%.
Right?
100%.
So you even said it. You're like, I want to know that I'm buttoned up. I want to make sure that I'm qualified.
Yeah.
And I don't jump in and bite off more than I can chew.
No.
That's why we collaborate.
Yes.
And that's a super smart lesson.
Yeah.
Because you don't have to be the number one or even, you know, solo gig. You can go in with others.
No.
Because, you know, the strength in numbers and all that.
100%. Look, what's the movie that just won the Oscar for, Parasite.
Parasite, yeah.
Okay. When they announced, best film, Parasite, 30 people were on stage.
Yeah.
30 people were on stage. And they're in South Korea-based film production company. And I can tell you, having been to Seoul and played South Korea, that to tell a conservative South Korean housewife slash mom, "Mom, I'm going into film," you might as well say, like, "I'm joining the circus." It's the scariest thing in the world. And yet, that's the first thought I had, is because having been to Korea, Seoul's a little less conservative, but there's a lot of conservatism there. And I thought of all the parents of all the people on stage who are sitting here going, like, they're watching television in South Korea going, "I can't believe it. My daughter said, I told her not to do it. Yeah. I told her not to go into film. And look, she's standing there with an Oscar." Yeah. And there's strength in numbers. And I am 100%, I think I use the term risk mitigation 50 times a week when I look at everything. I'm looking at everything that I'm into and going, how can we idiot-proof this? How do we idiot-proof this? Because what I don't like is to fail. Nobody likes to fail. And you learn from failure, though. And you have to be willing to fail. I know that between the TV show I'm doing over here, I'm doing two TV shows that I am executive producer of, a film, new album with OneRepublic, singles with Jonas Brothers and Diplo and other people. Not all of them are going to succeed, without question. I want all of them to be hits. I've covered them in bubble wrap, creative bubble wrap, with smart people who know how to execute, the best directors, the best producers, the best writers. But even still, I know that the probability states that not all of them will succeed on the level I want them to.
Yeah.
But that's part of me also doing five different things.
Well, and I was going to jump in to say, we also have to remind ourselves time and place, right?
Yep.
You know, back to the airplane metaphor, we're really glad that the pilot doesn't take chances.
Oh, yeah.
But in songwriting, you can take chances. It's all about risk-benefit, risk-reward, right? So in songwriting, you can afford to, write a melody, write some lyrics, maybe it doesn't go anywhere.
Yep.
You start over, maybe even shelf that.
Yeah.
And you come back to it a year later and it's something else. That's okay.
Yeah, that's fine. I refer to a term that I use called ROT, return on time. Yeah. And ROI is obviously a phrase that we all know and you know all too well with the stack of interviews you've done over the years. But ROT to me is the thing that matters at this point. I love a lot of things. That's always been my curse. I used to get so stressed out in high school, knowing that I was like countdown to 18, countdown to figuring out what I'm gonna do. And I was tortured because there were so many things I wanted to do. And I could be equally as exuberant and I could sales pitch you on five different career paths with equal level of exuberance and complete lack of hyperbole, being 100% authentic to my interest in those things. Now that I'm in a place where, early on, I read a quote, and I can't remember for the life of me whose quote it was. I think it was some famous old investor. And he said, money isn't the point, and it's not. Money is the byproduct of understanding your reality, and executing on it to the best of your abilities, whatever that is. So if you understand the degree to which you can understand your own reality and your natural gift set and your bandwidth and all those things, and however you're able to lean into that and maximize it, money finds you. So I don't, outside of investing, everybody wants to make back the money that they've earned, right? And with interest. outside of investing, when I look at everything else, whether it's film, TV, all those things, yes, I want a good deal. I want to be fairly compensated. But I look at my return on time. I have a family. I have two kids. I've traveled for the better part of 12 years because of One Republic. I've, on a touring year, we'll do 400,000 flight miles in a year. We tour this summer with Macklemore and in the fall, and I'm limiting the amount of touring that I do at this point, but we're still doing a healthy amount. I want to squeeze every drop out of every day, and my return on time has to be maximized. So if I look at three or four different things and I have to pick one, I will look at ROT. Which one, if I enjoy all four of them equally, then it becomes more of a financial and family decision. Mm-hmm. Which one of these, given the same amount of time, if all things are equal, my enjoyment is equal, which one of these gives me has the highest likelihood of compensation, of greatest compensation, and will allow for the most amount of time that I can spend with my family and be a normal human?
Yeah, the joy equation.
The joy equation.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. And that's a moving target at all times. And in the entertainment field and other fields, you can't anticipate. You can't always with 100% accuracy predict. Some things that actually have garbage return end up becoming time bandits and suck way too much of your time away. Mm-hmm. And it's the older you get, it's identifying the people that you know are time bandits, because we all know those people, and the scenarios. And you can only learn those things from experience, where you go, I've seen this play out before. I've read this book. This doesn't end well.
Yeah.
I'm not gonna open that the first chapter.
Isn't that incredible? It's so intuitive. Like, the only way to get wise,
yeah,
right, is through experience.
That's it.
And the only way to get experience is through making mistakes.
Yeah.
And so it's this wash, rinse, repeat process where you're going in, mitigating risk,
yeah,
making mistakes, learning, iterating, pivoting, whatever you want to, adjusting,
yeah,
and then becoming a little smarter the next time so you don't hopefully repeat the same mistake.
Yeah.
And eventually, and some people, you know, they get lucky out of the gate, you know, at a young age.
I know those people. and I used to get really upset by that when I was younger.
Yeah.
And now I just go, they have no idea how lucky they just got.
Yeah.
And that, I don't care that they're 25. I'm old enough now to go, that probably won't happen again for them. Like on that level, they don't know yet that they just struck gold, because they don't have enough perspective to understand the magnitude of what they just stumbled into. Didn't I love you? Didn't we fly? Know that I still care for you. But didn't we say goodbye?
Just on Hippos back to back to be like, why do I? The only difference I will say is I prefer the new baseline.
Good.
I prefer the new baseline. 100% prefer the new baseline.
The chorus drop.
The chorus drop.
Good.
100%.
It's a slight deviation.
It's better.